Thank you. gathered on the feast of St. Jerome, patron of this parish, one who was passionately in love with the Word of God, devoted to interpreting the Word of God. We ask for Jerome's inspiration from the Holy Spirit tonight, so that the Lord may reveal His will to us as we break open the Word. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and thereby prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. We're sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
sacred scripture. Grant that your people may be ever more fruitfully nourished by your word and find in it the fount of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you. Lectura de la segunda carta a Timoteo. Te doy estas instrucciones, aunque espero ir pronto a verte. Pero si me demoro, sabrás cómo portarte en la casa de Dios, es decir, la iglesia de Dios vivo, la cual es el pilar y la base de la verdad. En efecto, qué grande es el misterio de la bondad. Se nos apareció hecho hombre. Su causa triunfó gracias al Espíritu, y la contemplaron los ángeles, proclamando a todas las naciones. Fue crecido en el mundo, glorificado en el cielo. Palabra de Dios.
Then every described what's been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of the household who brings from his storeroom both the new and the old, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Savage, Bishop Sensory, associate pastors, deacons, sisters, lay faithful, who provided so many wonderful activities, youth programs like People on My Mind, English as a Second Language courses for new immigrants, a parochial school that had a long and good run, educating tens of thousands of children, music ministries like Troupe Eclat, French isn't very good, but Creole is worse, and charismatic and spirituality groups like the Legion of Mary and Crucio, Tenoir du Christ and Jeune Disciple Jésus. So many of these wonderful groups that minister to people beyond what normally happens in a parish setting. So decade after decade, as the community evolved from its early Irish and German roots to become a welcoming community to Haitians, Trinidadians, and those from other Caribbean islands, the storeroom of St. Jerome's has been filling with memories, wonderful celebrations, of personal encounters with Christ. That's what it's all about. People meeting Jesus and his living word, which is preached from the pulpit and lived out in the community. So tonight we gather on the feast day of Jerome, your patron, who was, as many of you know, who was one of the greatest students of the Bible the church has ever known. Jerome was a holy priest who lived at a time of great social change, lots of upheaval in the society. The Roman Empire was collapsing in his adult life, and people were searching for something to hold on to. Jerome knew that only faith can see us through times of upheaval, times of personal trial. We hold on to faith in those times. He himself was born into a wealthy family around the year 347. He received what we would call today a privileged education in the capital city of Rome. The young scholar, he loved to listen and read poetry, especially the poetry of Cicero, a Latin poet. He lived a kind of carefree existence until a crisis happened. Poor Jerome almost had a nervous breakdown. We're not sure what it was, what brought on the crisis. Maybe just a sense of his life had no direction, no meaning. He was searching, and then Jesus appeared in a dream to Jerome, and he said to him, "Jerome, what are you? What are you becoming? Are you becoming a lover of Cicero, a poet? What are you?" And Jerome in the dream meekly answers the Lord. He says, "I don't know, a Christian?" And then Jesus said to him, "Well, Jerome," quoting Matthew's gospel, "Jerome, where your treasure is, there is your heart. What do you value most? That's your happiness." So after this dream, Jerome kind of woke up and he said, "I gotta find myself. I have to find the truth about my life, the truth about my destiny." And so he put on a travel expedition. He went searching for truth, and he traveled to the great centers of culture in the Roman Empire. He went up to Trier in Germany, then over to Lyon in France, and then over to Antioch in Syria, the other end of the Mediterranean. All the while, he was searching for truth. Not only about the religion he was born into, Catholicism, but also the truth about himself and all that stood in the way of his happiness. And like other young people, like his friend with whom he often fought, St. Augustine, Jerome struggled with all kinds of temptations of the flesh. He struggled with a kind of a bad temper, You know, he was given to fits of anger and depression, but he persevered. He persevered. And he found Christ. He found him speaking in the pages of Scripture. The Word of God was not just a dead letter on a page. It was the living Word of God. And his life came together. And he found purpose. He found his vocation. He became a priest. What saved Jerome was his passion for the Word of God, Jesus Christ. And we can capture his attachment to the Word by noting his three great accomplishments, what I would call his three great accomplishments in his later life, which made him later on declared a doctor of the church. We don't have many doctors of the church among the saints, but Jerome is one of them. Three things, three accomplishments. Jerome prayed the Word of God. Jerome translated the Word of God. Jerome lived the Word of God. So I want to say a few brief words about each of these accomplishments. Jerome prayed the Word of God. That's right, he studied the New Testament, but not just as a scholar. It wasn't just a head trip for Jerome. I mean, he was brilliant in his knowledge of ancient languages. He was a smart guy. But Jerome went to the Scriptures in order to hear the voice of Christ speaking to him about his own life. It's the same motive, right, that leads many of us to join Bible study groups, right? Word on fire, living the Eucharist, living and learning by faith. There's so many of these programs out there that help Catholics uncover the Word. Renew. Now it's called Arise, Levantete in Spanish. I'm not sure what the real version is. What is it? I'm not going to try to repeat it. You trust me. But all these programs are meant to do the same thing that Jerome was doing in his life, going to Scripture, hearing the Word as contemporary, speaking to the circumstances of his own life. And still speaks to people today the same way. People want to know what God is asking of them. People want to know what the Lord's path is on the journey of life for them. People are searching for meaning. The Bible, the Holy Word of God, is the place where we go. The fountain of meaning, the fountain of truth. For all Christian believers, not just for evangelicals and Pentecostals, but for Roman Catholics, and for all of our brothers and sisters in our communion of faith. For years, Jerome lived in a cave in Bethlehem, which one can still visit, by the way, today if you go on pilgrimage to the Holy Land. You can go to Jerome's cave. And there he went, and he opened the Bible, and he said, "Lord, speak, your servant is listening." I spoke to him, and he came into that deep, abiding, personal relationship with Christ that meant everything to him. Hence, he coined that expression, which we associate with St. Jerome. Ignorance of Scripture is
ignorance
of Christ. Exactly. So, Jerome teaches us by the way he prayed the Word of God. He also, his legacy is also one who translated the Word of God. It's a second accomplishment. He translated the Bible, the Old and New Testament, into what was then the common language of the people. And the common language of the people then was Latin. He kind of went in the opposite direction of what we did as a church back in the 1960s. We translated the Scriptures and the Mass out of Latin into the vernacular. French Creole, English, Spanish, whatever the vernacular local tongue of the people might be. Jerome had to do the opposite because the people spoke Latin in those days. And the Bible was only available in Greek or Hebrew. He people to hear the word of God, just as he heard it in their prayer life, in preaching the word on Sunday at Mass. So Pope Damasus, for whom Jerome was a secretary, the Pope saw the brilliance of this young man, and he said, "Jerome, I have a project for you. I want you to translate the Bible into the language of the common people." And Jerome set to work. He studied up on his Greek. He was an A student in Greek. Then he tried to learn Hebrew. He was a C-minus student in Hebrew. He struggled with Hebrew. Very different sounds, the strong guttural sounds of Hebrew. He just couldn't master it. But he did his best. He persevered. He worked hard. And the fruit of his labor was the translation of the Bible that lasted the church down to the present time. It's called the Vulgate. It became a bedrock of Western culture, Western civilization. And it became the Bible that the people read and heard week after week when they assembled for worship. It was one of the great works of scholarship in the history of the world. Jerome, praying the word of God, he translated the word of God, and he lived the word of God. There are times when simply studying or preaching the word is not enough. And it happened in the early decades of the 400s. In the year 410, the 9/11, September 11th of the 5th century happened. Rome was sacked by the barbarians. The barbarian king Alaric moved into the city with his army and just destroyed everything. People fled Italy. They fled the city of Rome on boats to North Africa, to other parts of the Mediterranean, and some made their way to the Holy Land. Jerome saw these refugees disembarking the boats, and he recognized some of them because he had lived and worked in Rome. There were noble women for whom he had been a kind of spiritual director, a kind of Bible study leader, if you will. And he met with them, he helped them find lodging, he raised money for them, he ministered to them as a pastor, as a father, and he wrote this letter to a friend. He said, "I cannot help them all, but I grieve and I weep with them. They've lost their homeland. They've lost all their possessions. I'm completely given up. I've completely given up on the duties which I formerly had as a scholar. I put aside my commentary on the book of Ezekiel, which we've been working on, and almost all my study, I put it aside, because today I must translate the words of Scripture into deeds, into acts of mercy and love. And instead of speaking saintly words, I must act on the word of God." And Jerome then spent the next 7 years feeding the hungry, consoling the homeless, the sorrowful, doing all kinds of works of mercy that the Bible enjoins on all of us who say we are Christian, in fact, and not just in name. So this is the final lesson. The final lesson from old St. Jerome, our patron. This beautiful life. At the end of his days, he became a living embodiment of the Word of God. And so must we become living embodiments of the Word of God. The Word we hear preached in this pulpit, Sunday after Sunday, in this church and other churches that are our homes. What good is it if we only have this faith? St. James wrote in his letter in the New Testament, "What good is faith unless we put it into practice?" James the Apostle said. At the necessary time, Jerome put down his pen. higher. And that's why he's a saint. Sure, he was smart, but he also had a heart on fire with love for God's people. That's why he's a saint. Finally, there's a story about the final days of Jerome's life. In fact, his final hours. He was there in Bethlehem, still living in the cave that had become his home, his lodging. And the story goes that as he approached his death, Jerome lay on the floor of the Church of the Nativity, on the historic place where Mary is said to have given birth to Jesus on the first Christmas. As an old man dying, worn out by his years of travel, worn out by his labors as a scholar, and all the pastoral service he had given to the refugees, St. Jerome hugged the floor of the Church of the Nativity. He hugged it and he wept. He held tightly to the very place where the eternal Word entered our world and became flesh in the baby Jesus. May you and I always hug the Word of God. May you and I always cling to Jesus, our Lord and Savior. May the Word become flesh in our lives, just as it does every time we gather for Mass. The Word becomes the flesh of the Eucharist. May it become a living flesh in our works of love, in all that we do for our families, our neighbors, our fellow Christians. May the Word of God live on in this parish, in this place, for generations to come. St. Jerome.